great to be with all of you this morning. My name is Charlie Dunn, and what a joy it was to get to celebrate Easter Sunday with those of you who were here last Sunday. It was the Sunday on which we were able to welcome more people to our campus than we've ever had before on a Sunday morning. 423 adults and kids joined us for Easter worship, and we had our 10 o'clock service, as well as the first time we've done the sunrise service out on the corner of Walnut Hill and Ferndale. 91 folks got up really early to be there to celebrate the resurrection. And I just love that picture of that public visible witness to Jesus. They're outside proclaiming that Jesus is Lord, that he is risen from the dead. A number of folks who were there I'm aware of who hadn't been to a church service before or hadn't been to church in a long time, they felt comfortable coming to that service. And so we praise God for that. And I want to say a special word of thank you because I know many of you really did a lot to make Easter worship possible. I think about Elijah and Sam and Pablo got here 5 a.m. to set up the AV for that service, and those who came to pass out programs or to greet or set up coffee, especially those in the 10 o'clock service who were serving with kids and childcare teaching, and they weren't able to be in the service because they were serving in that way. And so thank you. For those of you who served, one of the things I love about this church is just that spirit of servant-heartedness, willingness to help out however is needed. Today, we are going to kick off a new teaching series for the next 8 weeks. And the title of that series is The Armor of God. And I realize that the topic of this series might feel a little bit jarring to talk about this metaphor of warfare right after a 8-week series on gentleness. So be gentle, be loving, be kind. Now let's talk about armor and warfare and violence. Maybe just those two things don't seem to really square very well together. And yet let me make it clear from the outset that the warfare that we're talking about in this series is not a warfare that is directed towards other people. Paul, in verse 12 of the passage that Madeline read for us, says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood." So this is not a war that's directed against other people. It is not a culture war. This is not a war that's fought with guns or bombs or any physical violence whatsoever. But the kind of warfare we're going to be talking about is a war that is fought within our minds, within our desires, within our hearts, within our thought life. That's where this warfare, this battle takes place. And I would suggest to you actually that thinking back to this last series, if you want to be the kind of person who exhibits the humility, the gentleness that we talked about in that series towards other people, that actually it will be to the degree that you learn to fight this internal battle, that you learn to be a person who is able to put on the armor of God. One of the things I've done in preparation for the series is I've gone back and I've been rereading a really famous book on spiritual warfare by C.S. Lewis. It's called The Screwtape Letters. Maybe some of you have read this book before. It's written from the perspective of a senior devil who is instructing his nephew devil on how to go about working with his patient, as he puts it. And at the beginning of this book, C.S. Lewis says, if you want to know the true mark of hell, the mark of Satan or demons or those who are under their sway or influence, he says, it's not what you see in Hollywood. It's not heads spinning. It's not eyes rolling back. It's none of that. He says that the true mark of hell is what? It's a ruthless, unsmiling concentration upon self. Somebody who is so egotistical, somebody who's so absorbed with yourself that you're very easily offended when other people criticize you. Somebody who very easily is moved to wanting to seek revenge. You hold on to grudges in resentment. Those who are prone to really get angry and to react harshly towards others. In other words, if you want to exhibit the gentleness that we talked about in our last series. You want to be somebody who can respond to criticism, attack, insults, difficult situations, mistakes that other people make without getting harsh or angry or offended, but instead to respond with gentleness, with a softness, with a control of your tongue. In many ways, it's because you've learned to fight this battle internally. Because you've learned what it means to really be a person who can put on the full armor of God. Paul says in verse 10, he says that we are to be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. And remember, we said in our last series that meekness is not weakness. That in many ways, if you're going to be a person who is gentle towards other people, that gentleness comes from a very real inner strength. You have to have a lot of inner strength. You have to have a lot of inner security in who you are in Jesus. And that's something you have to learn to fight for every day. In many ways, I would suggest, actually, if you want to live a life that's marked by gentleness towards others, you have to learn to fight this spiritual battle within, to be somebody who can put on daily the armor of God. But there's a second reason that I think maybe the timing of this series might feel a little bit jarring to you, namely the fact that last Sunday was Easter. We celebrated the victory of Jesus. We declared victory. We said Jesus, in his death and resurrection, he triumphed over sin and Satan and death itself. We said that the resurrection of Jesus is the guarantee that victory is assured. That one day Jesus is going to come back. God is going to win. Jesus is going to renew and restore everything broken in this world. Ultimately, there will be no one and nothing that opposes the good and gracious rule of God in that restored world. And so maybe it also feels a little bit jarring to one week say victory and the next to say strap on your armor and get ready for a fight. How do we make sense of that? How do we square that? And I think one of the paradigms that can help us, not only today, but all throughout this series, is for those of you who are World War II history buffs, you know that really the most important battle, the most decisive battle in World War II, was fought on June 6th, 1944, a day that's now known to history as D-Day, literally Decision Day. It's called that because it was such a decisive battle when those 160,000 Allied troops stormed the beaches of Normandy, and they were able to successfully launch a land invasion into Europe. When that battle was won, victory, ultimate victory in Europe, was all but assured. And yet imagine if you had been the commanding general on that day. You win that great battle and you gather up your troops and you give them a victory speech and you congratulate them. You tell them to break out the champagne. They start drinking bubbly and you tell them, listen, really from here on out, victory is basically assured. So from here on out, it's going to be one long victory parade riding to Berlin through France together. And these soldiers, they go out and they start riding along on this path through France, and suddenly there are bullets flying. There's enemy fire coming at them. They're ducking for cover. What do you think your soldiers are going to say to you as their general? They're going to say, hey, might have been a helpful safety tip if you had warned us, if you had told us we're going to be facing live, intense enemy fire. And in many ways, actually, that was the most intense fighting that took place in World War II as those soldiers made their way to Berlin. I think a good general would say, look, yes, this is a big victory. Ultimate victory is all but assured through this, but there's going to be a lot of intense, dangerous fighting still left along the way until the end. And I think similarly, for those of us who are Christians in this room, yes, we can affirm Jesus' resurrection is the assurance of that ultimate victory. And yet, we shouldn't be mistaken that until that day that Jesus returns, absolutely, we are still going to face strong, real, dangerous spiritual resistance, all the more so if you are a person who wants to be an agent of that resurrection life that Jesus came to bring. You're wanting more of that resurrection life to be true in your life and to share that with other people. You can guarantee that you're going to encounter real spiritual opposition and resistance as you do. And so Paul, like a very good general then, at the end of his letter to the Ephesians, in Ephesians 6, he gives this warning. He tells the Ephesians, he says, look, you need to put on the full armor of God. And what we're going to do over the next 7 Sundays is we're going to look at each of the different pieces of that spiritual armor. And what does it mean to put on those pieces of armor? How do we do that, practically speaking? But today, we're going to start by just looking at a couple of the major themes that I think are crucial to any warfare, any battle. Anybody here ever heard of a guy by the name of Sun Tzu, who wrote a book called The Art of War? Art of War, it was written in the 5th century BC, a Chinese manual on warfare, and it's been used, it still is used by military officers and their training today in both the East and the West. A lot of corporate executives have tried to apply the principles of this book to competition. Bill Belichick with the New England Patriots, this was his manual for how he wanted the Patriots to go about winning Super Bowls, The Art of War. And the most famous quote from this book is this. Here's what he says. He says, if you know your enemy and you know yourself, you need not fear the results of 100 battles. If you know yourself, but not the enemy, for every victory gained, you will suffer a defeat. But if you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle. Just got to know your enemy, and then you got to know yourself. We could put it this way. You've got to know the power that you are fighting against, and then you've got to know the power that we are fighting with. And so today, by way of introduction, we're just going to look at those two things together, the power we're fighting against and the power that we are fighting with. So first, and at greater length today, the power that we are fighting against. What's the power that we are fighting against? Paul says in verse 12, he tells us, he says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And if that sounds scary to you, it's because it is. And it should. Paul wants it to sound scary to us. But you know what doesn't sound scary? I'll tell you what doesn't sound scary is the voice of my 3-year-old son, Patton, when he likes that song that Pablo let us in, Holy Forever, that we sang earlier, whenever he sings that song in his little voice and he gets to those words where it says, all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, whenever he starts singing that, I chuckle, I smile, because I think these big, significant words are coming out of the little mouth of somebody who has really no idea what these mean. But I think most adults probably don't know what these mean either. Paul talks about rulers and authorities and dominions and powers, and a lot of adults have debated in commentaries, what are these different categories? What are these forces, these persons that Paul seems to be speaking of here? It's not very clear. But you know, it is clear from Paul's teaching and Jesus' teaching. What is clear is that when Paul talks about the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms, he's not talking about something impersonal. He's not talking about some vague, impersonal, evil force, like if you're a fan of the, you know, Star Wars, like the dark side. He's not talking about some dark, evil force. But what he's talking about actually is very personal. He's talking about specific persons here. When he talks about these forces of evil in the heavenly realms, what he means by heavenly realms is these are heavenly sorts of persons. They're heavenly. They're angelic in their nature. You see, the Bible teaches that when God created the world, he created all things, this whole expansive universe, all the immaterial things, as well as the living things, plants and animals, and that God created two orders of persons. He created human beings, and he also created angels. And the Bible has a lot more to say about humans than it does about angels, because after all, it's our story of redemption. It doesn't say a ton about angels, but it does teach us a little bit about angels. But one significant place is in the teaching of Jesus. In Luke chapter 10, Jesus sends out 72 disciples. They go and they minister and they preach and they heal and they come back and they are amazed because they find that they are able to cast out demons in Jesus' name. And when they say this to Jesus, here's how he responds. He says, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." And what he's talking about there is he's saying, I saw the day when this angelic being named Satan, who sought to put himself in the place of God, who thought he would be like Almighty God, was cast down. He was cast out of heaven. And what's more, 2 Peter 2:4 tells us that not only Satan, but a whole host of other angels, now fallen angels, were cast out of heaven as well. And though these angels have been cast out of heaven, the New Testament teaches that they are still powerful. They have power not only within their own ranks, but sometimes they're referred to as rulers, authorities who have influence and power within this world. In fact, specifically, 2 Corinthians 4, Paul refers to Satan as the god of this age. And then in Ephesians chapter 1, he calls him the prince of the power of the air, or the ruler of the power of the air. If you read the New Testament, you will find that both Paul and Jesus regularly teach that there are these real personal, intelligent beings, these angelic powers, who have a great deal of power, a great deal of sway, a great deal of influence within this world, and they are far, far more powerful than any one of us sitting here in this room. That they are far more powerful than we are. And for some of you, maybe as you're listening to this sermon so far, it sounds like I've entered the realm of science fiction. Like this is not sort of how you make sense of the world. Others of you are thinking, how, if the only exit is that little door at the front, how do I subtly sneak out of the room now? Or this guy looks like he has more than a third grade education, and yet he believes in the devil and in demons. I mean, is he serious? Does he really believe in this stuff? And I got to be honest with you. I've said this before when this has come up in other passages of Scripture. I don't often think about this. Spiritual warfare, the devil, demonic reality, evil forces in the heavenly world, that's not a category with which I tend to make sense of the world. I believe in an unseen spiritual God. I trust the authority of the Scriptures, and yet very rarely do I look at a struggle? Do I look at a problem? Do I look at a sin issue and think about it in terms of demonic evil activity? I'm Presbyterian. My default is to go to other kinds of rational kinds of explanations, to think about people's psychology, to think about different social structures, economic structures, certainly think about our own fallenness and our own flesh and sinful desires in our own heart, but very rarely do I ascribe the evil in the world and in our own lives to some kind of demonic influence? I think part of why I even was drawn to want to lean into this series is because I think that sometimes my perspective, maybe this is true of yours too, can really be truncated. That we're missing something of the New Testament view, something of Paul and Jesus' view of reality. I mean, think about it this way. How do you make sense of what is truly evil that happens in the world? When something happens that's not just tragic, but it's truly evil. I mean, I think all of us would agree, like the gassing of millions of Jews in death camps in Poland, that's evil. Or press ganging African children into armies and then getting them high on drugs and forcing them to go out to fight other people's battles, that's truly evil. sex trafficking of women or boys and girls, we would look at that and say that's truly evil. When somebody decides they're going to go into a school or a shopping mall and they're going to start shooting and killing people there, we would look at that and say that's truly evil. But how do you explain it? What happens in that? Is that just man's inhumanity towards other people? You know, maybe more progressive explanations, people would say, you know, well, the issue here is not enough education. People have these prejudices. We need more education around prejudices, or we need more access to mental health resources. That's what people need. More conservative answers maybe would be to say, well, the issue is a violent culture, violent video games, violent movies and TV. We got to address that violence in the culture, or we need more policing or more military so there's a greater deterrent towards these kinds of actions. But, you know, whether it's a more progressive answer or it's a more conservative answer, don't miss, they're both still flesh and blood answers. They're both still answers that remain simply within the realm of flesh and blood, man's inhumanity towards man. But what if there's more to it? What if the explanation is broader than that? What if there's more to this world than meets the eye? What if there really is this unseen spiritual realm? What if there are really ways in which these personal fallen angels, these spiritual forces actually do work and have activity within people's lives, that they're able to play upon the sinful desires that are already there in our hearts, but to maximize those, to intensify those, to strengthen those desires in a way to wreak real evil and havoc within the world? What if there's more to the world than meets our eye? In a way that we make sense of the evil that happens out there? Even, I think, in the way that we make sense of the evil that happens in our lives personally. Probably the most interesting thing that has struck me this week in preparing this passage is in verse 13, when Paul says this. He says, "Put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground." Now remember, Paul is writing this to Christians. Christians who are indwelled by the Spirit, who are united to Christ, but he says, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes. What is that? What's the day of evil? I don't look forward to that. I don't know what that is. What does he mean by when the day of evil comes? And as I've thought about it this week, I think what he's talking about there is he's saying, look, there are some days, even in the life of the Christian, days that just seem evil. Have you ever experienced one of those days? Maybe it's a day when you just find yourself just reacting to people and circumstances in really angry ways. Maybe it's a day where you wake up and just the world seems really dark. It seems bleak. You're apathetic. You're struggling to get motivation. You feel more indifferent towards God. Maybe it's a day when you feel like there's just almost this irrational fear and anxiety. Maybe it's a day when you feel like you're really just facing a lot of temptation. You feel like you're being prodded along, almost as if like there's this shadow alongside you in the day. Maybe it's a day when you feel really beat down. You feel really accused. You feel really condemned, really guilty. It's almost like there's a presence or something that's prodding you, that's egging you on in some way. Have you ever had a day like that before? Or maybe even in your circumstances where you look and it just feels like everything is going wrong in that day. And sometimes maybe it's in precisely the ways where you're trying to do what you know is right, what you know is good. Maybe you're trying to advance God's cause or kingdom or church in some way. And it's like there's this irrational, inexplicable opposition everywhere you turn. It's like everything goes wrong on that day. How do you make sense of that? You just shrug it off? Just chalk it up to coincidence? Yeah, I just had a bad day, sometimes we say. Or do you think to yourself, you know, maybe I just really am screwed up. I'm never going to get this Christian thing right. And you get down on yourself, or maybe you become more fearful and paranoid because you think this sermon, you think, maybe there really are spiritual forces at work. Or Do you take a more holistic perspective and do you stop and you say, hang on, maybe this is a day when really there are these personal spiritual forces of evil that are arrayed against me. And so, boy, this is a day where I really need to put on the armor of God that I might be able to make my stand. But I'll tell you who never says that. You're never going to say that unless you believe that we really do have an enemy, that we are really engaged in this spiritual battle. You'll never say that unless you believe that Satan and these personal forces of evil, that they really do exist and are active within the world. My wife, Brandy, and I, a couple weeks ago, we watched together, the first time she's seen it, the movie The Usual Suspects. And I hadn't seen it since I was in high school. I cannot recommend it. It's much more crude in the language than I remembered, but we watched that movie, and there's a villain in the movie named Kaiser Sose, ironically played by Kevin Spacey. And so there's this moment where he speaks. It's a very profound line. He says, the greatest trick the devil ever played was convincing the world he didn't exist. C.S. Lewis says something similar in the Screwtape Letters. He says, you know, one mistake we can make is to give too much power, too much credit, to constantly be thinking about Satan and demons. He says, they like that. We shouldn't do that. He says, but the other danger is that we just don't think about Satan at all. And he says, that's the trick he's playing in our Western secular world today. We are completely unaware. We don't even think about his activity or presence at all. And Satan loves that. Because that what that means is that all of his schemes can go completely undetected. You know, Paul says in this passage that we are to put on the armor of God so we can take our stand against the devil's schemes. And he's got a lot of schemes. And so part of what we're going to do in this series over the next several weeks is we're going to talk about some of those schemes, some of those tactics, some of those ways that Satan tends to operate in our lives. Deception, temptation, accusation, those are some of the primary schemes that he uses. If you want a simple definition of temptation, it's getting us to think more highly of ourselves than we should so that we're willing to do things we know we shouldn't do. Accusation is Satan's way of condemning to get us to think more lowly of ourselves than we should so that we're willing to do things we know we shouldn't do. But part of what we've got to do in this series is to begin to recognize what are his schemes, how does he work, so that those don't go undetected. Because if they do go undetected, even worse, you're going to go through life unprotected. You're not going to wear the armor of God. And here's the thing about battle and armor, is if you go out into battle and you're, you know, the arrows are flying around you, you're in the midst of a battle, you know, the enemy's breaking through the breach. They're coming in with their spears and the swords. That's not the moment to say, time out. I need to slip into something more appropriate. Let me get into my armor. Let me make sure that I'm ready for this. Paul doesn't say, hey, carry around the armor with you so that if you need it, you can put it on. He says, no, you better put it on because you're going to need it. And once you need it, it's going to be too late to put it on if you're not already wearing it. Now listen, I realize for some of you, you get into military metaphors and analogy. Others of you, you're kind of hesitant about that. You don't like the idea, are we kind of glorifying military and warfare? Because actually, you know, in many ways, warfare, it's not glorious. If anybody needs a reminder of that, there's a new movie on Netflix, All Quiet on the Western Front. It's based on the old book. You read that. I mean, World War I, they went out for God and glory and country. And very quickly, everybody was disabused of this idea that war is glorious. Paul is not using this metaphor to try to glorify warfare. He's using this metaphor because he's saying, look, this is serious. We really are in a real serious spiritual battle. And if you go through life kind of unaware of that, indifferent to that, like you can be neutral to that, if we're lazy about reading scripture, if we're not people who are regularly infusing our minds and our lives with God's word, or if we never really develop a real prayer life, where we're talking to God regularly, we're confessing sin, we are praising him, we're surrendering to him, we're again bringing our hearts into alignment with his will. If you're not actively seeking to put to death known sin areas in your life, what the New Testament calls footholds for the devil. Be that lust or pride or revenge, anger, bitterness that you're holding on to. If you're not actively seeking to put those to death, if you're not actively seeking to take up the armor of God, well, then when you are attacked, and you will be, you'll be defeated, often enslaved, often rendered spiritually ineffective to be able to do the good work that God is calling you to do through your life. Friends, we're facing a real spiritual enemy. I'm not mindful enough of that. I assume probably many of us are not mindful enough of that, but Paul says we need to be. Because if you think that you can overcome this enemy in your own strength, you can't. You're a fool. So we need to know something of the power that we're up against. We're going to see that more in this series. But then lastly, more briefly, we also need to know the power, not just that we're fighting against, but that we're fighting with. Because though we face a formidable enemy, not once does Paul say, hey, you should flee. Not once does he say, hey, you know, run while you can and seek to save yourself. No, he says, we've already been saved, so stand firm. Stand firm, be strong in the Lord. And Paul speaks of this power that the Lord has given us. Stand firm in the power of the Lord. And when he says this, Paul is actually, he's referring back to a power that he's already referenced back in Ephesians 1, verse 19. Here's what he says about this power there. He says, God's incomparably great power is for us who believe. That power is the same power that he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead, what we celebrated last week. And remember, Jesus wasn't just raised from the dead as Jesus raised a little girl or as he raised Lazarus. Jesus was buried under the weight of all of our sin, and the power with which God brought him back forth to life from the dead, the very power with which now he is exalted at the right hand of God, ruling over all things for the good of his church. Paul says that is the power that is available to those of us who are in Jesus Christ as we go about this struggle. That is the power in which we take our stand. And over the next several weeks, we're going to talk more about what that looks like. How do you put on that power? How do you draw on that? How do you put on the armor of God as we engage in this spiritual battle? But let me just say this today, is that when you think about the armor of God, what is the armor of God? Generally, what Paul's talking about here is he's talking about Jesus. The armor of God, it's Jesus, and it's the gospel. It's who Jesus is for us in the gospel. It's what he has done for us in the gospel. The belt of truth, it's not so much our personal integrity. The breastplate of righteousness, not so much my personal righteousness. No, he's talking about Jesus's righteousness. In many ways, each part of the armor is like a different facet. It's a different aspect of the one singular gospel, the good news of what Jesus has done for us, the battle he's already won in our place. And so to put on the armor of God, in many ways, it's to learn to trust in the truths of the gospel and to apply those truths in specific ways to our lives, to apply the battle that Jesus has already won for us and to draw on that victory. And we'll talk about that more in the coming weeks. Let me just give you one example. We'll take one piece of the armor today. So how about the breastplate of righteousness? So Satan, I said, you know, two of his primary tactics are what? Temptation and accusation. So let's say he comes with temptation. He says, hey, you've worked hard lately. You've really sacrificed. You've really done a lot of good things, most of which have gone unnoticed. You deserve to indulge. You deserve to neglect your family. You deserve to be selfish. You deserve to give in to whatever that guilty pleasure might be. You deserve that. It comes with that temptation. What do you do? Well, what it looks like to put on the breastplate of righteousness is to say, well, wait a second. I know. Why did Jesus come? He came to fulfill all righteousness, he said. That means that he was tempted, that he was tried in every single way, and yet he never gave in to sin. And why did he do that? In order that he could make me right with God. That's why he did it. And am I going to disregard all that Jesus has done for me By choosing to give in to this fleeting pleasure, no, I'm going to put on the breastplate of Jesus' righteousness. Or maybe it's accusation. Satan comes and he says, do you remember what you did last night? Do you remember what you did yesterday? Do you remember what you did 10 years ago? Do you know the hurt, the suffering your sin has caused to other people, to the heart of God? There's no way God could really love you. And he comes with that accusation. What do? You put on the breastplate of Jesus' righteousness. You say, Jesus already died for that sin. And what's more, now he has credited his righteousness to me so that now when God looks at me, he doesn't see my sin. He sees Jesus' righteousness covering me. You put on the breastplate of Jesus' righteousness. Friends, the decisive battle really isn't ours. It's Jesus's. Jesus has already fought the decisive battle in our place. Our job, though, is to trust that. Our job is to put on the armor of God, to learn to really believe and trust those specific truths of the gospel so that when the day of evil comes, we're ready, we're able to make our stand. And so let's pray as we come to the Lord's table together this morning. Lord Jesus, if there's one takeaway that we have from this morning, we pray it would simply be a recognition of how much we need you. Jesus, you told your disciples that apart from you, they could do nothing. And we want to be more sober-minded. We want to recognize just how much we need you. If we want to experience the freedom and the joy and the abundant life that you have come to bring for us, that we need you. And Jesus, we pray that you would help us to take those truths of the gospel that we've already sung about together, that we've heard together, and that we are about to taste and see at this table together. And we pray that you would help us to trust those truths of the gospel. This coming week, help us to trust those truths, to put on the full armor of God, that we might be able to stand. The victory, Jesus, you have won for us. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Friends, on the night.